Good evening, everyone. Thanks, Daryl, for the introduction. Yes, we met about six months ago, I think sometime in September last year. We began conversations about what we could do or how we could collaborate. And I'm very excited to be here this evening. I see a very young and diverse crowd. Don't get up and leave. I'm not here to sell you insurance. But instead, I'm here to talk about something I feel all of us are very passionate about, and something that impacts all of us in many, many different ways. You know, the issue of healthcare and what is it like? Obviously, here, predominantly for people in Singapore, you know, whether the current healthcare model works, is it sustainable? You look across, you look at different countries, everyone has a different system. You know, how does insurance feature within that, all of that space? And of late, there has been a lot of press, a lot of you know, government discussions, a lot of dialogue with the citizens and the residents here about this issue of healthcare. So I thought it would be a really good platform, you know, for once to tap on resources outside of the industry, to tap on all your thinking minds to see how we can, as one, you know, come together to hopefully solve some of the issues. How does this work? Okay. I have to introduce Prudential in case you are not aware. We are the British, the UK life insurer, so we're not the Prudential Financial, which is a US company. We are the UK one. We share the same name. We've been in Singapore more than 80 years. We are a leading company here, and the entity in Singapore actually just got our AA S&P rating yesterday. We are one of the market leaders in the provision of healthcare in the integrated plan, the MediShield, MediSafe approved insurance plans. There are five companies that do that, and that plan offers comprehensive healthcare at restructured as well as private hospitals. And that sits on top of the basic government provision, which is known as MediShield. I mean, I believe having a good healthcare cover, good healthcare insurance forms the bedrock of any financial plan, any retirement plan you have, because this is the one thing you will use the most when you get old. Okay, contrary to what many people believe, they think they will just get out of bed one day and they will die, or they will meet with an accident and they will die. Unfortunately, that happens maybe less than 5% of the time. Most of the time, your demise is preceded by an expensive and long illness. That is at least what our data shows us. Okay. Like I said, healthcare is a growing concern for Singaporeans. And there's the issue of increasing cost, especially of usage of private facilities, private hospitals. Singapore has become, you know, quite a bit of a medical tourism hub. Many of our neighboring countries, many of the many millionaires that are formed in the region daily come to Singapore to seek its very high quality and relatively inexpensive healthcare. But inevitably, that drives up the prices as well. And that's been an issue. Right, you would have seen in the newspapers the premiums for the MediShield going up. You will see soon when they introduce MediShield for Life, which is basically universal coverage for all Singaporeans and permanent residents, you will see as a result, premiums will rise as well. You know, consumption of healthcare kind of stays this way, and when you hit maybe 70, 75, it just goes up, right, exponentially. So, you know, I'm not sure if people have really thought about how we're going to be funding this bit. This bit, I think now, we can take care of, you know, but the bit beyond 75 is still a big question mark. So, we are trying to put a challenge out there. I mean, we've termed it the challenge to predict the cost of seeking treatment for individuals, therefore enabling them to make better healthcare and financial planning decisions. You know, some ideas that we have: can you predict the number of people admitted to hospitals in 2013 based on previous year's data? You know, how can actually some data point of healthcare costs predict further subsequent usage, etc.? Now, Gotta understand, insurance companies use a lot of data. A lot of it, mainly for pricing purposes, mainly on the actuarial side. This is somewhat breakthrough leap of faith for us, right? We seldom share the information we have externally. It is a big, big leap of faith. And I'm hoping with this challenge to actually be able to tap on some of your thinking, right? And naturally, it will be different from ours, it will be out of the box. It will be considerations that we probably have never even thought about. And hopefully, we can actually collectively solve some of the issues, right? For example, you know, just escalating healthcare costs. Just this big question mark about where should I go? Which doctor should I see? Why is Dr. A more expensive than Dr. B for the exact same treatment? In case you didn't know, right, there is this fee when you go to the hospital called professional charges, and it differs from doctor to doctor, and it can be very different for the exact same treatment, and the doctor with exact same seniority as well. So we're hoping with the data we put out there and with all the work the data scientists or data enthusiasts can come together, we can have some ideas, some resolutions, you know, and something easy for the man in the street. You know, I was discussing this with Daryl, and you know, with the data challenge I hope to accumulate in the weekend hackathon, where I'm trying not to be too simplistic about this, but perhaps someone can create an app where you can put in every consumer's hand that he or she, whoever they are, can hit that app and then look and says, this is the best place I can go and seek my treatment. Why? Because I don't have to wait very long. That's one issue with hospitals. You go and you take a queue. Or because it is the most cost-effective one that, you know, the models have predicted. So that will be instantaneously useful for everyone. And I hope something like that will come out of the challenge. The data we will make available will be sample hospital bills. There's kind of five data fields here: hospital name, procedures, cost, date of admission, diagnosis. I'm still working through the information, but we will put probably up to 20 data fields available. There's public information that will be made available as well. You know, things like base occupancy rate, public hospitals, private hospitals, the different costs, different specialties, the average inpatient bill tables, etc. And we'll try to work with the Ministry of Health to get more and get richer sets of data out there for everyone to look at and analyze. So the deliverables, submissions, we're trying to see if we can get to a predictive model that can be accurate, innovative, help identify some key drivers that are insightful and unprecedented. One of the things I'm thinking of is, you know, you could see in the data a trend, a specific trend, an increase in one type of illness and an increase in the cost of treating that illness. And maybe what we can do, rather than fight that, look at how we can actually prevent, what we can do to prevent this trend from going up, right? Some of the fixes that can be done that could lower the increasing occurrences of such illnesses. And this is, again, a different dimension to understanding the data. So we're looking at the short proposal, some analysis methodology, some insights, some suggestions on implementation, and external research data, if applicable. You know, like all data challenges, there will be a cash pool. I should tell people how much it is, right? And the cash pool is $15,000. We will have the most compelling proposals present and hopefully be able to share into that cash pool. So more details will follow. I think we are putting data live sometime in the second week of March. So look out for that space. Thank you very much. Yeah.